try to keep you inside of the grave. The enemy fought you, he tried but he lost. You cannot be stopped. When we cried for freedom, you tore down the walls. The weight of our burdens, you carried it all. Our fears and our faiths hang dead on the cross. You cannot be stopped. Stand against you, Lord. Not death, not the grave, the powers and principalities of this world. God, nothing can stand up against the power and the might of our God. So, Father, we've come to declare that truth, that you are mighty, that you are holy, that there's no one like you, oh Lord. Father, we love you. Right now, we're drawing near to you. We want to be in your presence. God, I pray for in faith, Lord, this morning. God, as we're singing your truths, God, as we're singing of how great and amazing you are, Lord, I pray that you would remind us of those things, that you would build our faith and our hope and our trust in you and in you alone, Jesus. Father, magnify yourself as we continue to sing to you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Nothing that our God can't do, amen. Let's sing this out.
Just one word, calm the storm that surrounds me. With just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. With just one touch, my eyes are open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can melt. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. Nothing that our God can't do. Just one word, you heal what's broken inside me.
Yes, you do.
Just one word, you revive every dream. With just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. It's not a mountain that He can't move. Praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. song you'd ever sing. You're worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you.
Come on, let's declare this.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you.
Holy.
Turn in your Bibles to 1 Timothy 2. And then also Jeremiah 29. And it's good to have you here. I want to welcome everybody who's joining us online. 1 Timothy chapter 2, Jeremiah chapter 29. And we're back in our series in that portion of the New Testament that we call the pastoral epistles. And these are the three letters that Paul wrote to two young pastors that were both facing some hard times in ministry. And we're calling this study Blueprint for a Healthy Church. And so 1 Timothy was written to Timothy, who was now pastoring the church at Ephesus. And you'll remember that Paul planted that church, he pastored that church, he raised up a group of elders, he moved on. And after he moved on, what happened in Ephesus is what happened in most places where Paul pastored and then moved on, and that is that the churches didn't fare well. They fell under the leadership of false teachers and people who introduced unbiblical practices. So Paul leaves Timothy there to take over the churches in Ephesus and to get them back on track. And then later he writes this letter, 1 Timothy, to encourage Timothy to just stay the course and to finish what he's there to do. So chapter 1 was Paul reminding Timothy that healthy churches are first of all Christ-centered, and then they're built upon solid biblical doctrine and solid biblical practices. And so as we got into chapter 2 last week, we began what's going to be a multi-week study that we are titling When You Gather. And the whole purpose of us looking this closely at chapter 2 is that Paul is basically saying the church needs to have orderly church services. And in the church services, believers are equipped, and they're equipped to serve, they're equipped to grow, but as we're going to see today, they're also equipped to impact their communities. And that happens in various ways. And today we're going to talk about something very specific. So last week was part one, and we called it the priority of prayer. And Paul told Timothy how to pray. He told Timothy who the church should pray for. And I want to review that with you. Look up at the screen. In fact, you're there, 1 Timothy 2, verses 1 and 2. Paul says this. He says, therefore, I exhort first of all, in other words, the most important thing. And he says that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, and all who are in authority. We went kind of deep into that last week, and based on the feedback that I received last week, that this is what I'm taking away from your feedback, is that most of us are more than willing to pray for and to give thanks for those government authorities that we like and that we agree with, even though they may be far and few between these days. But when it comes to those that we don't like and we don't agree with, do you know that we are more apt to criticize and to complain about them than we are to pray? That's the feedback I got. I had a lot of people tell me, I need to repent, I need to change, I need to pray for this administration or whatever it is. And so last week's study seemed to really touch our hearts as a church. I know that just to teach these things, I have to get my heart right first. Well, then Paul goes on and he tells us why we need to pray for our government leaders. Again, look down at verse 2, and we're just going to look at part of the verse. He says that we, speaking of Christians, but more specifically, we as the church, the gathered body of Christ, he says that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence. And last week, we kind of defined that. And this is what I said to you last week. Paul seems to be saying that we need to pray that governing authorities would simply leave us alone to practice our faith and to live according to God's word. That we are not asking for special privileges. We're just asking for the government to keep themselves out of our faith and practice. Amen? It's basically what Paul says, and he says, pray about these. Pray that we won't be restricted by state intervention. And we talked about things we've seen, especially since 2020 and the pandemic and stuff. Well, one of the things about prayer is that prayer never stands alone. Prayer throughout the scriptures is always a precursor to specific actions. And today we're going to have part two of this study, When We Gather, and we're going to call this the priority of citizenship. And we're going to begin by standing, as we do on Sunday mornings. Let's honor and revere God's word, and let's just read 1 Timothy 2, 1 through 4 together. And we're going to pray, and then I'm going to have you turn to Jeremiah chapter 29. So let's read. Are you ready? These are Paul's words. He says, "Therefore, I exhort, first of all, that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, and for all who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth." This is our focus for the morning. And Father, we're praying over these words, and we're praying, Lord, now that since we've spoken an entire week on the subject of prayer, now, Lord, we come and we talk about the action that comes after the prayer. And I pray, Lord, that you would really open our hearts to receive from what your Holy Spirit is going to speak to us in your word today, and that regardless of our personal opinions and our traditions and our past, that your word would impact our present and our future, and that we could be more aligned with what you desire individual Christians and the church to be when it comes to these things we're talking about. So we yield ourselves to you this morning. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a seat. Turn in your Bibles to Jeremiah 29, and you'll see when we get there why. But I want you to just, as you're turning in your Bibles, to kind of imagine back to the time that we're reading about here in 1 Timothy, where Paul has written this letter to Timothy. Timothy has personally assimilated it, and then on a Sunday morning, he stands up in front of the gathered church, and he reads chapter 2 of Paul's letter, and then he gives a Bible study, maybe very similar to the one I gave last Sunday, and he tells the church, go home, pray about this, come back this evening, and we're going to have a question and answer session. So as you're leaving this morning, drop some questions in the offering box. And so the church gathers on Sunday night, and Timothy stands up and says, all right, you guys have had the afternoon to pray, and I've pulled one question out of the box, and it's going to take us the entire evening to talk about it. So he opens up the question, and he reads these words, and this is what somebody from the church has written. They said, hey, pastor, I want to do what Paul commanded, but I also want to do more than pray. Can you give us a Bible study on what it looks like for us to lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence while living under a government system that opposes and is often hostile to our faith? And I imagine that having read that question, Timothy would say, wow, that's a tough one. But if you turn to Jeremiah 29, I think I can give you five principles that will teach you how to go beyond just prayer, on how to live and lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence in the midst of living under a government system that opposes and is often hostile to your faith. And Timothy says, I'm going to do that. So everybody turn to chapter 29. And I'm going to give you a Bible study on Christian citizenship and politics. And so everybody would turn. And to kind of veer from our imagined story for a minute, I see that this is right where our nation is. I see that these are the same questions that Christians in America are asking right now. And it's because you and I are living at a time when our nation is more divided over social issues and over political issues than any time in my short 25 years of life. Or so, something like that, right? And what I'm noticing is that it's creating division. It's creating division in families. It's creating division in the workplace. It's creating division among friends. But worst of all, it's creating division within the one place where we are supposed to experience unity, and that is the local church. And it could be because a lot of people are approaching politics from a place of tradition and personal opinion and things like that, rather than biblical guidance. And so what we're going to do today is we're going to ask that question, how can you and I, as 21st century Americans, Bible-believing Christian Americans, how can we live in this nation that gives us the ability to impact the direction of national policies while still pursuing peace, godliness, and reverence? And in Jeremiah 5, we have, I'm sorry, 29, we have five principles that teach us how to prioritize Christian citizenship and also to impact our nation in a godly manner. So what I've done for this morning is I've taken a message that I gave about a year or so ago from Jeremiah 29, and I've kind of reworked it to fit where we are today in 2 Timothy chapter 1. And I'm just going to give you five principles that if you put these things into practice, I think you're going to realize I am impacting my nation. But at the same time, I'm doing so peacefully with godliness and with reverence. And so I hope to throw out a challenge this morning that's going to be a blessing to you. The first principle that we're going to look at is found in Jeremiah chapter 29, verses 1 through 3. And we're going to call this embracing your dual citizenship. We're called to embrace our dual citizenship. I'll read verses 1 through 3 and then I'll set the scene for you. Beginning in Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 1. We read, these are the words of the letter that Jeremiah the prophet sent from Jerusalem to the remainder of the elders who were carried away captive, to the priests, the prophets, and all the people whom Nebuchadnezzar had carried away captive from Jerusalem to Babylon. And then we have a little historical note. This happened after Jeconiah the king, the queen mother, the eunuchs, the princes of Judah and Jerusalem, the craftsmen, and the smiths had departed from Jerusalem. The letter was sent by the hands of Elasa, the son of Shaphan, and Gemariah, the son of Hilkiah, whom Zedekiah, king of Judah, sent to Babylon, to Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. Now, that's a lot of history. That's a lot of background. That's a lot of information. So I want to take a minute and just set the scene. Those of you who regularly attend here on Wednesday nights, this should be pretty familiar to you because it was just last year that we went through the book of Jeremiah and we slowed down. We took an entire night to really dig in to chapter 29. But for those of you who maybe are not familiar with this portion of scripture, I want to set the scene. The year that we're reading about is 597 BC, and that's a significant time in Judah's history. Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, he attacked Jerusalem on three different occasions. The first was 603 BC, and that's the time that he carried off the brightest of the best. So that's the story of Daniel and his three friends that were taken to Babylon. And by the time that we're reading about here, Daniel was probably already serving in the political structure of Babylon. So the second attack of Nebuchadnezzar on Jerusalem was 597 BC, and that's the time really that we're reading about today. And what he did is he took the religious leaders, he took the political leaders, and then he took a lot of the people of Judah and carried them off to Babylon. And then the third was, of course, 586 BC, and at that time Jerusalem was completely destroyed. And the remainder of the people were either killed, scattered, or carried off to Babylon. We're focusing on the time just after the second attack in 597 BC. And at that time, Jeremiah was still living in the city of Jerusalem. And God prompts him, as we read there, to write a letter to the priests, the prophets, the politicians, and the people that were living as captives in Babylon. Now, I'll tell you why in a couple of minutes, but I just wanted to set the scene. And in a minute, we're going to look at the content of this letter that God has Jeremiah send. But before we do that, what I want you to see here is that Jeremiah is writing to citizens of Israel that are living in the ungodly and sometimes hostile land of Babylon. And this is what I want you to really catch. I told you that our first point here is to embrace our dual citizenship. A big part of what Jeremiah is telling the captives living there in Babylon is that they need to embrace their dual citizenship. They were citizens of the nation of Israel, but they were living in Babylon. It's a very interesting concept. Look up at the screen. I think this is what Jeremiah is trying to get across to them. He says, most of you are going to spend the rest of your lives in Babylon, but don't forget that you're citizens of Israel. Look at the difference of those words. You are in Babylon, but you are a citizen of the nation of Israel. And you need to live like a citizen of Israel while you're residing in Babylon. And I hope you're starting to kind of track with me, because we find this principle all over the New Testament as you and I, as believers, are being addressed by the apostles who wrote Scripture. Jesus addressed this also, but we won't take the time to look at that. Look up at the screen. Since Timothy was pastoring at Ephesus, I thought it would just be great for us to look at the introduction to the letter that Paul wrote to the Ephesian church. And in the New King James Version, Ephesians 1:1 reads, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, now look at the wording, to the saints who are in Ephesus and faithful in Christ Jesus. Do you see the dual citizenship there? We are followers of Jesus Christ, but we are in the place that God has put us. In this case, they were in Ephesus. You and I are in the United States, specifically the upstate of South Carolina. Look at this verse in the NLT. I really love the way it's worded in the NLT for our purpose today. Paul says, this letter is from Paul, chosen by the will of God to be an apostle of Jesus Christ. And he says, I am writing to God's holy people in Ephesus, who are faithful followers of Jesus Christ. If you and I consider ourselves faithful followers of Jesus Christ, that's our citizenship. We are citizens of heaven, but we are living in South Carolina, in the United States. So we have dual citizenship. And what Paul would be saying to us is the same thing that Jeremiah was saying to the Jewish captives. He says, you're going to be here a while. Probably the rest of your lives. I was hoping that would get some laughter, because we're all going to be on this planet for the rest of our lives, no matter what. Okay, but it's first service. Second service always laughs at the stuff you guys don't laugh at. You need more coffee before coming to church. Paul would say to us, you are citizens of the kingdom of God. You're faithful followers of Jesus Christ. But you are also citizens living in the United States of America. And you need to live like citizens of the kingdom of God while you're here in America. And that is a very, very important responsibility. We're talking today about citizenship, about having a big understanding of our dual citizenship. And I want to talk to you about that word citizenship. It actually means politics. And you may say, what? And you guys know I am not the most political person in the world. I believe my pulpit is about the Word of God first and foremost. Amen? However, we need to understand that when we're talking about politics, we're talking about something very specific. And if you do a study on the word where we get our English word politics, lights begin to go off and you begin to say, hey, I need to think about this a little bit differently. Because the word politics comes from the Greek word polis or polis, which basically means a city or a city state. And then you have another Greek word that comes from polis, which is politeis, which describes a resident of the city who has responsibilities to their city. And so when we're talking about citizenship and we're talking about politics, one commentator gave a statement that I think really helps. One commentator defined politics as the art of living together in community. The art of living together in community. Understanding that we live in a polis, and I am a politeis, I am a citizen, and I have certain responsibilities to the place where I live. That's basically what politics means. I hope that for some people that's like, wow, that's a revelation. Because oftentimes we have a different idea of what politics is. So in Jeremiah 29, God ordained the citizens of Israel to live as citizens in Babylon, but God's goal was this. God's goal was that their involvement would transform Babylonian culture, and in the same way, he's ordained that you and I, citizens of heaven, live here on earth in the United States of America, knowing that our involvement will transform American culture. And so that's the first point. The next thing that we're going to see here in Jeremiah, after learning that we're supposed to embrace our dual citizenship, God tells them to execute their responsibilities. Look at verses 4 through 6. And this is where we get to the core of the letter. This is where Jeremiah is now going to say, hey, thus saith the Lord. This is what God is telling you as you are living as a citizen of Israel in the land of Babylon. And I want you to notice that this is directed to the priests, the prophets, the politicians, and the people of Judah living in Babylon. Verse 4, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all who were carried away captive, whom I have caused to be carried away from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and dwell in them, plant gardens and eat their fruit, take wives and beget sons and daughters, and take wives for your sons and give your daughters to husbands, so that they may bear sons and daughters, that you may be increased there and not diminished. In a nutshell, God uses the pen of Jeremiah to tell these Jewish people living in the ungodly city of Babylon that they need to get involved in their communities. And he emphasizes three practical ways for them to do so. Look back at the text here. He says, you need to build houses and dwell in them. I think this is really important that we see this, because I think a lot of Christians make a huge mistake when it comes to this concept here. But notice that he didn't say to isolate themselves by building Jewish communities within Babylon. God says, hey, I've scattered you to Babylon. I'm scattering you throughout Babylon. And I want you to become part of your communities. God says, I have ordained that you would live side by side with the Babylonians. I want your kids to play with their kids. I want you to coach the sports teams where there will be Babylonian kids playing the equivalent of Babylonian baseball with your kids. Ladies, I want you to share recipes with the Babylonian ladies and teach each other how to do things of a domestic nature. Guys, I want you to spend the weekend with your Babylonian friends adding high-performance accessories to your chariots in the driveway. You know, this is what God is saying. He's saying, don't be an isolationist. And it's crazy how many Christians think that our job is to isolate ourselves from our community when God says, I have sent you into your community. And you've got to be something very specific. We'll get there in a minute. But look at what else he says. He says, plant gardens and eat their fruit. That's the equivalent of saying, go out and get a job so that you can support yourself. Or go start a business so that you, as a Jewish business owner, can employ Babylonian people and you can give them the God of Israel day in and day out. It's like God saying to you and I, don't just hire Christian people if you own a business. Hire people who need to hear the gospel. Hire people that you can pour into, and you can become a productive member of your society and teach others to do it. Look at verse 6. A lot of words to simply say, raise a family. How often do we hear right now, man, I don't want to have kids and bring them into this world. I want to save my kids from what this world is throwing at them. Listen, there is a biblical concept that goes all the way back to the Garden of Eden where God said, increase and multiply. Increase and multiply. Let's just have tons and tons of kids and grandkids, and let's teach them the ways of our God so that they can go out and they can impact our communities. But the big thing is, he says, we need to increase rather than diminish. We don't want Christian people diminishing. We don't want people saying, listen, don't have kids because it's a really hard world to raise kids in. Have lots of kids. In fact, I'm going to give you a recommendation. Have grandkids first. They are amazing. You know? We won't go there today. But listen, why is God commanding the Jews to do these three things? Why these three specific things? Build houses. Get jobs. Multiply. Look up at the screen. Because later Jesus would come, he would say the exact same thing, but he would say it a different way. He basically says this to a group of people that were living under Roman control, not Babylonian, but under Roman control. And up on the screen, we have Matthew 5, verses 13 through 16. Jesus says, you are the salt of the earth. Remember that salt added flavor to bland food, but it also had a purifying and a medicinal effect. And the Lord is saying to you and I, as believers living in the United States of America, he says, as God says, as I spread you through your communities and I put you in key places, I'm doing it because I want you to cause people to be thirsty for me and hungry for me, and I want your purifying effect to be out there in every realm of society. Don't isolate yourselves. Go out and be part of your communities. He says, if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. So the whole idea, your salt has to be out there being salty. You can't hide with a bunch of other salty people and just say it's us four and no more. It's us against the world. You know, build a barricade. Don't let anybody come through those doors. Jesus is saying, get out there into your community. And in case you didn't understand that, verse 14, he says, let me give you a second analogy. You're the light of the world. And light repels darkness. What do you do when you get up in the middle of the night and you hear, you know, a creak in the house? You go out in the living room and you flip on the light, right? You turn on the light and the darkness flees. I know I see people whispering, they're like, I grab my shotgun and I walk through the house saying, you better not show it. Okay, we live in South Carolina. That's a great thing to say. Okay, anyways, he says, Lord, a city set on a hill cannot be hidden. In other words, if your light is shining and you're on this dark mountainside, people are going to see your light from far away and they're going to be attracted to it. And Jesus says that's what we're supposed to be. And so he also says they don't light a lamp and put it under a basket, but they put it on a lampstand and it gives light to all who are in the house. So let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. So God wanted the citizens of Judah living in Babylon to have a godly impact on the various cities and towns where God spread them. He wanted them to be present. He wanted them to be involved. He did not want them to be isolated. And that's a huge, huge biblical principle that we need to remember. So let's talk about parallels between these Jewish captives and Jesus' disciples on one side and then us on the other side, okay? You got the Jewish captives and Jesus' disciples living under the Roman Empire and the Babylonian Empire. And then you've got us, right? Well, they were both surrounded by a government that was led by very ungodly men and often hostile to their faith and hostile to their way of life. And so are we. Now, I'm not trying to comment on political leaders with a broad brush or anything, but it is often like that. But you and I have one privilege that the Jews living in Babylon and the Jewish disciples living under Rome did not have, and that is the privilege of being involved in shaping the government that we live under through something called a political process. We get to change our nation by being involved. And here's where, you know, I get very concerned, because a very high percentage of professing Christians refuse to be a politis, a citizen of a city, state, or nation that fulfills their responsibilities. And what am I talking about? Well, it kind of goes like this. We hear this every time there's an election, whether it's local or whether it's national. I'm not voting. Why? Because I don't like any of the candidates. How many of us have ever heard that? I'm not going to ask, but how many of us have ever said that? And here's what's interesting. I'm going to address this by giving you three quotes, and then I'll talk about it. During the 2016 presidential campaigning season, Dr. David Jeremiah was asked how he would advise voters who say that none of the presidential candidates represent their core beliefs. How many of us have ever said that? None of them represent my core beliefs. How can I vote for somebody that doesn't represent my core beliefs? And I love what David Jeremiah said. He said, everybody wants to find someone who represents who they are. Unfortunately, there isn't anybody like that. Not in this election, probably not ever again. So here's his advice. He says, we're down to the point where we need to elect somebody who we're pretty certain won't be against us, somebody who will allow us to live out our faith. So David Jeremiah is saying, hey, Christian, instead of not voting, examine the candidates and try to find the one. You're not going to find one that's for everything you believe, but try to find the one that's not going to be against the church, against Christians, against biblical Christianity. That was his advice. I'm going to go back a little bit further, all the way back to Plato, the philosopher. And he said to his students, the penalty that good men pay for not being interested in politics, and when I say politics, we're talking about stewarding our Christian citizenship, is to be governed by those worse than themselves. And then the final one, we've all heard this one. It comes from Edmund Burke, although I did learn this week that this is disputed. There's a bunch of people out there that say that Edmund Burke never really said this. So I don't know if he said this or not. No matter who said it, someone said it, and that is, the only thing necessary for evil to triumph is for good men to do nothing. And so here's the idea, is that in America, and especially among Christians, we've gotten this idea that if we don't find someone perfect to vote for, that we're just not going to vote at all. And what we're finding through statistics is that when Christians engage in our nation's political processes, we help. When Christians don't engage in the American political processes, we're actually contributing to things worsening in our nation, because we're not exercising the voice that God has given us in this great nation. And so God told the captives to embrace their dual citizenship. He called them to execute their responsibilities. Now he adds one that we spent all last week discussing, so I'm just going to touch on it. But he says here in verse 7, engage in prayer for your nation. Look down at verse 7 in Jeremiah 29. He says, seek the peace of the city where I have caused you to be carried away captive, and pray to the Lord for it, for in its peace you will have peace. As American Christians, you and I are very quick to act. And the reason we're quick to act is because in this great nation that we live in, we are given so many rights. So oftentimes, when something is encroaching into our rights, the very first thing we do is act. And I'm not knocking that. We need to act. We need to do whatever we can to keep the rights that God has given us as citizens when big government is trying to encroach into those things. But what Jeremiah is speaking to these Jewish captives is he's saying, listen, you should first seek the peace and the prosperity and the well-being of Babylon through prayer. Because when you do that, the peace and prosperity and well-being of Babylon, which is where you live, is going to then impact you. And so this is kind of a tough one to talk about, but what Jeremiah is saying to these captives is before you do anything, pray. And pray until God shows you what to do, and then do something. But the most important thing, look at Proverbs 21:1. This is what Jeremiah is trying to communicate. He says, and I'm going to kind of take some liberty with the text here, Nebuchadnezzar's heart is in the hand of the Lord. Like the rivers of water, he turns it wherever he wishes. So Solomon says, listen, the king, or you could say the president of the United States, or whoever is in charge of a nation in other places, his heart is in the hand of the Lord. And like a river of water, God is going to direct that man's heart. And what we learn here is that God directs the hearts of national leaders, and it seems that our prayers have a big part of impacting that. So what Jeremiah is saying to the people, he says, listen, don't not act, but he says, don't act rashly. Make sure that you're praying and acting in a biblical manner so that you don't make things worse. And so God just reminds them. He says, listen, do you want peace, prosperity, and well-being in your life, Christian? He says, then seek the peace, the prosperity, and the well-being of the nation that you live in through prayer and then through action. And we'll jump to the fourth principle here. It's found in verses 8 and 9. Jeremiah tells them to exercise wisdom and discernment towards, and I'm going to use the word candidates, and you'll see why in a minute. But I think this is an extremely important principle among the five. And you'll see why. Read verses 8 and 9, then I'll give the history. Verse 8, Jeremiah says, for thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, do not let your prophets and your diviners who are in your midst deceive you, nor listen to your dreams which you cause to be dreamed. For they prophesy falsely to you in my name. I have not sent them, says the Lord. Now, we have to talk about the context, then we'll talk about the application. But the context here, we have countless Jews that are now living in Babylon, and then we have a group of Jews that are still living in Jerusalem. There's the absence of a king at this time. The one king that was there was basically a puppet of Nebuchadnezzar. So the land was being led by the prophets. And so in Jerusalem, Jeremiah and a couple of very faithful prophets were speaking the truth that God spoke to them and that they could verify through the written word, through other parts of the Bible. And they were saying this to the captives. You're going to be in Babylon for 70 years and the city of Jerusalem is going to be destroyed and the Jews are going to be scattered everywhere. Not a very great message, right? It's not the kind of message that citizens wanted to hear. Now, in both Jerusalem and in Babylon was a second group of prophets, and they were speaking to the people, and they were saying, listen, God spoke to me. Thus say the Lord. God gave me a dream. And in less than 2 years, Babylon is going to fall, and we're going back to Jerusalem. Now, which message would you want to embrace if you were not really knowledgeable about the Word of God? I know which most people would say, I want Babylon to fall and I want to go back to Israel, right? Can we vote? Is that the message we want? Okay. Here's the idea. Jeremiah is kind of talking about what goes on in our land during election years where we have candidates from various political parties and they want us to vote for them, so they start telling us certain things. And you've got various parties, and each party is bringing forth a little bit of truth and a little bit of twisting of truth, and then there's just some outright lies. And it happens in every party, every single one. Sometimes people are like, oh no, my party, they're basically God incarnate, right? And it's not true. You know, it's not true. Politicians, well, you know how you know if they're lying, right? I ain't gonna say it. I can't believe you guys even thought that. Jeez, wow. So Jeremiah is saying to the Jewish captives, he says, you know what? You are going to listen to and support and get behind either me and the prophets that God sent, or you're going to listen to the false prophets, but you guys are all going to make a choice, and you need to exercise wisdom and discernment. And that's where you and I are at every time that we are dealing with an election cycle. We have to decide which group or which individuals we're going to listen to and get behind. And it is amazing when you start talking to people and you say, hey, why are you voting for that person? Well, he just seems nice. Or they might say, I like his hair. You know, they might say a million things, but I'm just going to tell you what I think we should be focusing on as Americans when we are going to exercise our privilege of voting. First and foremost, this is the United States of America, and I think we need to figure out if the different candidates are pro-America or if they are globalists. And if they're globalists, then they're not going to put America first, and they're probably going to do things that are going to hurt our nation and probably hurt our Christian rights in the nation. And then questions like this, who do you think they're going to appoint to the Supreme Court when they get that opportunity? And so we need to ask questions like that. Before I vote for somebody, what's their voting record? What's their track record? What do they support? What do they oppose? Are they upholding what we know as Christian values, or are they opposing them? Here's a couple more. Where do they stand on the sanctity of life, both inside and outside the womb? Do they support the biblical view of marriage? And what impact will their time in office have on the family, like on my kids and on my grandkids? These are some of the things that we need to look at and determine. And then there's one more, and I take a lot of flack for including this one, but I will include it every time I talk about how Christians should consider voting. There's a promise made in Genesis chapter 12 where God said to Abraham, I will bless those who bless thee, and I will curse those who curse thee. And I always look at a candidate, and I look at their policies and their history when it comes to either supporting or opposing the nation of Israel. Israel is not perfect, but God has a covenant with them, and there's some blessings that come with being a nation that supports Israel. And I want a candidate that upholds those things. So our prosperity and our well-being as a nation is tied to whether our government leaders oppose Israel or bless Israel. So those are things that I think about. I'm never going to tell you who to vote for. There have been times where we've had local elections and stuff, and we've put up on the screen the different views, and we've encouraged you to think biblically, and I've told you who I think represents a more biblical view and things like that, and I'll encourage you, I'll continue doing that in the future. But our last point here, I really want to emphasize this, and we're about to run out of time. So look at Jeremiah chapter 29, verses 10 through 14, and this will be our closing thought. We need to expect God to move. We've talked about a lot of things here, but the first four principles that we talked about could be summarized as our God-given privileges and also responsibilities. These are the things that God says you have the privilege of doing, you have the responsibility of doing as a citizen of the United States of America. And as we seek to be good stewards of our citizenship and good citizens, and we fulfill those four responsibilities, we then need to have this expectation that God is going to move. And that's exactly what he promised to the Jewish exiles in Babylon. He says, listen, do these four things, and patiently wait because I am going to move. Look at Jeremiah 29, 10 through 14. Thus says the Lord, after 70 years are completed at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good word towards you and cause you to return to this place. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace, not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you. And you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. I will be found by you, says the Lord, and I will bring you back from your captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and from all the places where I have driven you, says the Lord, and I will bring you to the place from which I cause you to be carried away captive. Now, there's a lot here. We're only going to focus on a small portion of it, and that is that their 70 years in Babylon was going to take place. They were going to be there 70 years. You and I are going to live here in the United States of America, most of us probably for the rest of our lives. And we need to have that idea that we're in it for the long haul. We're here until the Lord either moves us home to heaven or to some other part of the world. But during that 70 years, the Jewish presence in Babylon impacted the Babylonian culture. And for the rest of our lives here, our goal needs to be that as Christians living out our faith, glorifying God and the different things that we do, we are going to impact our culture. And one of the ways that we do that is exercising our responsibility as good citizens and being part of the political process of following what the scriptures say when it comes to these things. But it's interesting because at the end of these 70 years, the rebellion and the idolatry that brought the Jewish people into Babylon was purged from them. And as you and I live in this culture, one of the things that we should be experiencing as we look at the world getting worse and worse and worse is those things should be purged from our lives and those things should be purged from the church. And you see that God is multitasking. He's using us to impact the world, but he's using the world to show us how to be purged by the Word of God and by the Holy Spirit. And the Jews here, this is neat. God promised. He says, I am going to return your land to you. You're going home and I'm giving you your land back. And I wish I could tell you this is a promise for the United States of America. If we do our four things, God's going to give us the land back. Gosh, I wish I could do that. Don't you wish we could do that? But I think there is a principle here. Because Christians have been very, very complacent in the political process and even just being salt and light, we have lost a lot of ground. And I think that by being good citizens and living out our faith and voting biblical values and demanding that the people that we put in office actually uphold their promises, we could see change, folks. In a sense, and please nobody quote me wrong on this, but we could get our land back. The ground that the enemy has taken away, we can regain that through the things that we learned here in Jeremiah. And so, quick conclusion, and the worship team's going to come up. Last week, Paul ended chapter 2, or our section in chapter 2, by reminding us of this. The gospel is the most important thing for the church to focus on. Please don't ever lose sight of that. I just said it once this morning, I'm going to say it a second time. Probably 95% of my time in this pulpit is teaching the Word of God without some kind of a political agenda. You guys know that well, right? Can you attest to that? I don't think politics are the answer. I think the gospel is the answer. But I think the gospel impacts our politics. Amen? And so Paul said, I was called to be an apostle and a preacher and a teacher to the Gentiles. Paul said, first I preached the gospel and people got saved. Second, I taught the word and people got transformed. And then Timothy comes along and says, hey, let's talk about Jeremiah chapter 29. I think that we who are being transformed by the Holy Spirit can now go out and transform that world out there with the gospel because we have been given such incredible rights, especially here in America, right, folks? I know it's quite a challenge, and I know that I've touched on some things today that have made some of us uncomfortable. Go back, compare what I said with Scripture, and I think you'll find that unless I misspoke and used the wrong word or something, I think everything I said today was biblical. And I want to lay this challenge out before you. If you're one of those Christians that just says, I'm not going to be involved in the political process because I don't like the candidates, please rethink that. Build houses and dwell in them. Plant gardens, reap their fruit, multiply. And Father, I thank you for this time. The gospel is the key, Lord. But as the gospel goes forth and lives are saved and lives are transformed, then we want to be what the Bible calls a politis. We want to be citizens who take full responsibility for the city, the state, the land, the country that they live in. And I pray, Lord, that without making politics the primary thing, the gospel is the primary thing, but I pray, Lord, that we could be living in a healthy relationship with the world of politics so that we can see that our faith is actually impacting our world. And so, Lord, we pray today for everybody who is maybe wrestling with part or all of this message. Pray, Lord, that we could really think through, pray through, and allow your Spirit to speak to us. Because in America, so much more than any of the biblical examples that we read about, we have a voice. And I believe it's a God-given voice. And I pray, Lord, that we could let our voice be heard. And then we just trust you to change the hearts of the people who hold high offices, Lord. Lord, we pray that your word continue to transform our lives and that our lives would continue to transform this great land that we love and that we live in, Father. Call us to action. Give us specific things to do next, Lord. We thank you and we praise you and we ask you to make these things so in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh Lord, you're beautiful. Your face is all I see. And abounds to me. Oh Lord, please light the fire once burn bright and clear. Replace the lamp of my there'll be just